gender rebels, 50 influential cross-dressers, impersonators, name changers and game changers by Anneka Harry. Narrated by Anneka Harry, Maya Jama, Suranne Jones and Gemma Cairney. Introduction. Throughout history, women have had to make all sorts of compromises to be considered seriously, if at all, alongside their male counterparts. The sheroes who succeeded before us are never suitably storied or shouted about because they are the victims of a system that undervalues, ignores, and abuses women and girls. Gender rebels, 50 influential cross-dressers, impersonators, name changers, and game changers is a celebration of those who fought back. Women who have stuck their skulls above that parapet everyone's always banging on about. Women who've taken matters into their own hands and made quite the point about the cursed patriarchy while doing so. The 50 women you're about to non-stop party with, and maybe even mosh with, were and are diverse, defiant and daring. They are superbly spirited females who made the world shake and will still get us shook to this day. Those I've selected are by no means the only ones who had to pretend to be or presented as men at some point in their lives or careers, but they have gained enough fame or notoriety in their time to go down in history. That said, I needed to delve so deep into the vaults of the British Library to discover some, I was trawling eBay to try and get my hands on a Ghostbusters proton pack. My life as a female creative isn't exactly a laugh a minute, believe it or not. And I say female there because it's an industry-preferred prefix. A constant reminder that we are battling to be allowed to exist in the bollock-heavy bubble. Never mind all the tedious, archaic debates they're having about whether we're relevant, funny, talented, worthy, intelligent enough or not. The first time a TV commissioner told me, in no uncertain terms, that he wouldn't be making my obviously hilarious and Emmy-worthy show idea because I was the wrong gender, was understandably a right smack in the face. For the gender rebels who faced similar sexism and, as a consequence, went on to change their names or their dress, their stories are not a case of if you can't beat 'em, join 'em. Rather, pretend to be them to seemingly get anywhere. It's not as if they opted to do so because of a big, over-elaborate plan to avoid manspreaders or mansplaining that got out of hand. They chose to do so because they had no other choice. Every time I think the world is slowly changing on these issues, I continue to be smacked in the face. My belief has always been that if you want something enough, you'll find a relentlessness that smacks back. But we should be a million miles away from having to put up, shut up, or feel like we constantly have to have our fists up in self-defence by now. For me, it wasn't important that this book hit the shelves. It was imperative. Hashtags and handmade Instagrammable placards may have kick-started a new wave of feminism, but they are equally ignored and easily forgotten. Books aren't going anywhere. They're ensuring we celebrate women's histories, give voice to those who are silenced, and tell these untold tales. It doesn't change what went down, but it certainly helps us to look around the corner. Sorry to be a Debbie Downer, but rose-tinted reading glasses are not enough. We need to change the language so we reclaim these women from age-old and blatantly biased accounts by male historians. We need inclusive narratives that encourage us to rethink feminist action. And we need the books. We ain't waiting for the movies. Don't get me started on the hot mess that is Hollywood. The glass ceilings won't be smashed, the pay gaps bridged, or the patriarchy busted if we just sit around in unicorn onesies talking about it. Words inspire deeds. And researching these women alone has fired me up to not only write a book about them, but to fight back harder myself. Whoever we are, whatever we do for a living, and wherever we live, we are still having to compromise and use disguises to survive. Women and girls have forever been judged on how they look, while men have mainly been judged on what they say. Sorry to break it to you if this has blown your mind, although I very much doubt it has, as it's a fact that is impossible to avoid. A pernicious, pervasive truth that is having a negative effect on every level of society and holding us back from that equality finishing line at every turn. And sadly, it also happens among women. When I had to come out, because anyone that's not entirely straight as a line supposedly needs to do a press release on the matter, I had a barrage of jokes from other females, running their mouths, pondering if I'd be favouring Dr. Martens, Birkenstocks or Crocs with socks now. Crocs with socks! I know I'm waxing lyrical about equality, personal choice and not judging appearances here, but seriously, Crocs with socks! First of all, how dare you? Second of all, I said I was in love with a woman, not that I'd had a frontal lobotomy. Imagine a world in which women could go about their day looking however they liked and for their appearance not to be a constant conversation topic or erection agitator. Imagine a world where we could dress to make a statement if we so pleased and for that decision to be applauded and respected. Dreamy. Clothes do not maketh the person, though you should totally bump your own fists together if you leave the house feeling like you're dressing so fly you should change your name to Vinaigrette. Oh, and for the record, to be perfectly queer on the matter, Dr. Martens are hella cosy and I am about that life. Thank you very much. As discussions around gender evolve, we are finally challenging sex, sexuality, and identity stereotypes. We may be at an ellipsis bubble and work in progress stage of proceedings, but at least we are bubbling and progressing. There are women among the 50 who would certainly have a different experience today being able to describe themselves as intersex, agender, multigender, genderqueer, gender fluid, non-binary. Please insert identification term of choice here. Neither the aforementioned nor those who oppose in temporarily for personal gain were treated kindly, and accusations about them being sexual deviants, perverts, lewd lesbians, inverts and or troublemakers were never far away. The systemic delusions around LGBTQ+ and identification issues run deep and have, on many levels, produced a hellscape of otherness politics through which I've had to mine hop. As such, homophobic history would have us think that the majority of gender rebels still saw themselves as women while masquerading as men, but there will, of course, be some trans pioneers among the undecided, unlabelable and unboxable who fought the system. The mixture of motivations throws up all sorts of complex intersections, swings, roundabouts and even a couple of seesaws. Perhaps a pinch, or truckload, of salt might be required upon occasion. Perhaps this paragraph will be an even more bonkers read in the not-too-distant future. Fingers and flaps crossed. We can draw parallels between contemporary and historical identities, but appropriation should be reserved for profits and property, not people. If you believe and strive for oneness and kindness, I know you'll join me in reading between the lines of some of the pre-modern history book gobbledygook and assumption. For anyone who has even a speck of knowledge or insight into how women who speak up, achieve or try to are treated today, the experiences of some of these gender rebels might set off, for fuck's sake, alarm bells loud enough to make your ears bleed. But as a fervent, forward-thinking, full-throttle, alliteration-loving feminist, I believe in the power of history to help us feel comfortable with and inspirit the present. I think you do too. I love you already for being here, and long may we stay unitedly hydrated on solidarity juice. Keep supporting women and the world will see itself right. Big up yourself, because we are the people that can and will change the ending. Women across the globe are still having to masquerade as men to advance. Let's kill that. Let's redefine the power structure itself rather than the idea of powerful women. Let's dial up the feminism. Let's take up space. Let's wear whatever the heck we desire while doing so. Let's scream and ruddy shout. Let's grab them by the patriarchy. Let's get stuff done.
Hatshepsut, 1507 to 1458 BC. the ancient Egyptian powerhouse queen / king. Hatshepsut, meaning foremost of noble women, how's that about an opener for a book about women, was the fifth pharaoh of the 18th dynasty in ancient Egypt, only the second woman to reign and the first female to do so as a male. She is largely considered one of Egypt's most successful pharaohs, and if that wasn't enough woman power for you, you may have picked up the wrong book. I'm sure I told the designers not to make the cover too similar to The Idiot's Guide to Equality. If later on you feel like these early chapters are itty-bitty in comparison to the rest of the book, please remember we are bringing women out of the shadows from all the moons ago, where history and stories are as jumbled as a tin of alphabetti spaghetti. And in Hatshepsut's case, we're going back as far as an age when society accepted crocodile dung and fermented dough as an effective form of birth control. These were very nuanced times indeed. Some of the history books are as helpful as the Christmas cracker miracle fish when it reads your fortune as dead one, but I'm collecting all the dropped hints and slam dunking them for you because, as the author, I sort of have one job. Hatshepsut enjoyed an on the whole peaceful and prosperous reign and left behind more monuments and works of art than any other ruler. Of course she did. She was a she. She's even got she slap bang in the middle of her own name. So why is she depicted as a beardy bloke in most of the surviving artifacts? And why was that name omitted from the Egyptian kings list for thousands of years? Spoiler alert of a common theme that you may come across once or twice during this book. She had a vagina! And therefore she was maltreated and erased. Please join me in a boo hiss. May I let it be known that there is due to be a glut of injustice assaults on your own heart. Please join me in a boo hiss and may I let it be known that there is due to be a glut of injustice assaults on your heart. But we're not here to wallow and weep under the crushing weight of female oppression that has plagued society since day dot, are we? We're here to celebrate rebellious revolutionaries. And what better way to kick off than with a queen so mighty she got the other role sweating like a menemist attempting a four-piece jigsaw puzzle. A queen so formidable, Egypt panicked and decided the only thing for it was to make her a king. Hatshepsut took the throne in 1478 BC, by which point the institution of Egyptian leaders was already well over a millennium old. It was pretty stuck in its ways, and sorry to bring genitalia into proceedings again so soon into our relationship, if you didn't have a penis, you did not fit that regal bill. Our poor Hatshepsut was up against it from the get-go, and her family life wasn't exactly easy-breezy either. The only child born to the Egyptian king Thutmose I and his principal wife, Amos, Hatshepsut was expected to be queen. I use italics for principal, as old Thutmose boy kept a harem of side chicks and wives. Amos was simply his main squeeze. Not only did her dad have more wives than I've had catcalls while out jogging, at the mere age of 12, Hatshepsut was made to marry her half-brother when her father passed away, so as to preserve the royal bloodline. Now, apart from the whole child-bride and inbred marriage thing, the half-brother, Thutmose II, might not exactly have been Hatshepsut's first choice for many reasons, not least the rumours of a grisly skin condition that would sicken a trypophobic to death on the spot, and having to put up with a lifetime of him going AWOL on benders and being dragged half-drowned from the Nile. Luckily for Hatshi, casual nickname usage of one of the most celebrated and controversial women of the ancient world there, hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. That lifetime was short-lived, and she was a widow by the age of 30. What happens next may read like an episode of Keeping Up with the Thutmoses, but hang on in there. We're nearly at the bit where she claims all power over the country, empire, throne, and invisible kingdom of gods and spirits. As Hatshepsut had no sons and the pre-mentioned willy-waving royal rulemakers would never consider a woman, they found a son of Thutmose II's by one of his sideline baby mamas to take the reins and reign. But Thutmose III was too young to assume the throne unaided, so Hatshepsut took control of all the affairs of state until he came of age. In the seventh year of acting as his regent, she changed the rules and crowned herself Pharaoh of Egypt. Just like that. How she got away with it isn't exactly clear, but she had some influential supporters, and she was leaning in and asserting her authority left, right and centre. Perhaps there was a flash blip in the Matrix in 1478 BC, and all the men saw sense for a sublime, sacred nanosecond. Perhaps her pledge to save the country from fighting and killing and her offer to be king of peace and wealth, not war, was too good to miss. Perhaps she chanted, "Make Egypt great again." Perhaps not. The problem was, and here comes the whole having to dress as a man to get stuff done bit, rather than change the ideology, she ended up having to adapt herself to trad male forms to be taken seriously. She donned the kilts and crowns, and her pharaoh image was captured forever in artwork, showing her with a strange, snubby hipster beard in all sorts of lunge stances, reaching out and leaning forward. Women could only ever stand passively in the shadows with their head bowed and arms by their sides, presumably staring down the men, wishing they would burst into flames. This strong male iconography was vital to the concept of pharaoh and, apparently, the easiest way for Hatshepsut to royally represent, and represent she did. Hatshepsut went on to remain king for 20 years and flourish for them all, despite Thutmose III still being on the scene. She was Egypt's longest reigning ruler, before Cleopatra's indomitable 21-year reign beginning in 51 BC. And her beard endurance most likely lit the way for Cleo to dress freely in frocks and become everyone's favourite costume party crush. Some believe Thutmose III murdered Hatshepsut in the end, but whatever happened, he definitely tried to wipe all mention of her, backdating his reign to the death of his father and blotting out her presence entirely. A bitter man erasing a powerful girl from history? Who'd have thunk it? Forewarning, an abundance of tools are left in this book overnight. This certainly won't be the only one you meet. However, the Egyptian belief that one lives on as long as their name is remembered has been exemplified by Hatshepsut, since her memory was saved by Egyptologists and her temple at Deir el-Bahari remains one of the most impressive and visited in Egypt to this day. So there you have Hatshepsut. She served up real king of the humans with a side order of absolutely owning her virtue and feeling the fantasy. Let's make sure she is never forgotten again. Say her name. Sing her name. Chant it. Express it through the medium of crump. Tattoo it across your knuckles. Name your firstborn after her. It's like totally gender neutral. Get in there before the next some couple or other from the latest structured reality series crack onto it and ruin it for us all.
Hua Mulan, Northern and Southern Dynasties period, 420 to 589 AD. The legendary woman warrior and camel-riding queen. All cards on the table from the takeoff here. There's no actual archaeological proof that Mulan ever existed. But if Disney said she did in their 1998 animated comedy drama action musical box office smash that went down a total treat, then she must have been real. Can I get a whoop whoop? Walton Chums even went on to make Mulan 2. Further proof of her existence, surely, as everybody usually hates Disney sequels. Name me one thing that happened in Lady and the Tramp 2 Scamp's Adventure. In fact, name me one person who even knows who Scamp is. We should just be rejoicing in the fact that Mulan is a genuine-ish Wonder Woman who is still being championed all these thousands of years later. But enough about Disney for now. We all know what really happens when Disney princesses meet feminism, and it's way less pretty than any of their pooky ball gowns. I'm pretty certain Feminisney won't be taking the Oxford Dictionary's Word of the Year title anytime soon. But if it does, I'll eat my Disney hat. Mickey ears and all. The real Hua Mulan didn't have a cocky little red dragon sidekick because she didn't need to rely on anybody but herself, often thought of as a grandmother to all later historical female warriors. She first appeared in Chinese folklore, sometime between the 4th and 6th century AD. Although Mulan has gone on to be the star of films, operas, TV series, books, and even video games, she originally popped up in the form of a type of singing ballad known as Yufu, by an anonymous author in the Northern Wei dynasty. The story elements of the original, The Ballad of Mulan, remain mostly consistent throughout all retellings, but just so nobody gets their undies in a bundle over the details, if indeed you wear any, let's stick with the Yufu version of events. The poem is actually very short, considering how deeply ingrained it has become in Chinese, and later global, folklore and classic literature. There may only be 31 couplets to dissect, But you'll soon understand that Mulan's exquisite life choices were all there to be seen, broad as daylight, beans and the gender pay gap. For Mulan, life was pretty snore at first. It was described as a domestic one. The robustly defined gender roles in Chinese culture had her sitting at a weaving loom most days, and you couldn't even hear the sound of the shuttle over her sighs. We know those sighs, that's for sure. Back in Mulan's China, outlying tribes had invaded the central plains, and the government declared that every household must send a man to the front line without excuse or sick note. This was war, not double gym class. Mulan's pops was old and unwell. She had no older brothers, and so, without hesitation, she decided to take her dad's place in the Khan army. Women were absolutely not allowed to fight, but our girl was a jumpy jack, and she wasn't about to let a tiny thing like the ancient law of the land stand in her way. My forever mood. Mulan could only serve by impersonating a man, and so she set about obtaining armor, weaponry, and whatever other man paraphernalia she saw fit. The ballad describes how in the East Market she buys a spirited horse, in the West Market she buys a saddle, in the South Market she buys a bridle, in the North Market she buys a long whip. Now, call me spoilt by malls and the like, but I do wonder if she could have organised that shopping spree with a tad more geographical consideration. All that gallivanting about seems an awful faff. Mulan travelled thousands of miles and fought for her family and country for the next 12 years. She remained in disguise for the entirety, although later story adaptations go on to fill in some of the gaps. The ballad leaves gaping wide holes for imaginations to fill, and the fact that Mulan cross-dresses remains a focus because there are still gender taboos ruining this shindig we call society and this soiree we call life. Similarly, modern-day versions fixate on her somehow surviving her life among the men bit, the clickbait qualities of the tale, the dangers of women experiencing war and the constant threat of rape, sexual exploitation, or indeed death, are all high up on the suspense agenda. But Mulan was tearing down those notions long before the Netflixing chillers were demanding and box-setting strong, diverse female leads. Her efforts in battle were so top-notch that the top dog Khan offered her a top job as a top kick minister in his top-tier cabinet. But Mulan's plan was only ever to stick to her own. She dared turn down the Khan's promotion and instead asked for a camel so she could ride home to her family. I love this part of the story for two reasons. One, imagine the Khan's face when somebody said no to him. That ego bruise must have smarted hard. And two, a camel was never part of the deal. Upon returning to her village, history loves to have us think that Mulan put on her old-time clothes, changed her hair, and in a J-Lo montage-type sequence, artistic license in force, re-J-Lo, made a big fuss about putting her makeup back on and re-emerging as a woman. Don't be fooled by the rapier that she's got. She's still Mulan from the block. No matter where she goes, she knows where she came from. From Northern Wei. Mulan presented herself to her male companions, who all flipped out like the locals from downtown wherever after a dynamo trick. In the midst of war, the soldiers clearly weren't distinguishing between sexes. Everyone was simply just trying to stay alive. Take from the ballad's conclusion what you will, but I think it's pretty crystalline. The buck bounds here and there, while the doe has narrow eyes. But when the two rabbits run side by side, how can you tell the female from the male? I have no explanation for the decision to use rabbits to make a gender equality point, but if this was an English exam paper, you wouldn't need a double-digit IQ to score high. You'd only have to join the dots and write something along the lines of, "Stop underestimating the female rabbits. Female rabbits are dope," to get an A star. These days, Mulan's story is taught in Chinese schools. She has shrines across China, and several localities in the country claim to be the hometown of our hero. She ain't going nowhere. Way more than just a time-honored classic, she has transcultural, universal appeal because she has ultimate life goals. Word on the Strasse is that modern-day adaptions have turned Mulan into a feminist, but she clearly always has been. Mulan escaped the humdrum domestic sphere, cross-dressed to get ahead, worked tirelessly for her family and country, and kicked some serious badunkadunk during proceedings. Female empowerment at its finest, surely. Mulan is still an evolving tale, with brand new meanings and messages every time. But I think we can all sleep soundly knowing that they will continue to cross boundaries and get more and more drop the mic with every year.
St. Marina, 715 to 750 AD. The devil-beating monk and her baby father. St. Marina, aka Marina the Monk, aka Marina the Ascetic, aka Marinus the Monk, was a real fan of a moniker. It's sort of like when you try to give yourself a nickname at school and you realise you're the only one referring to yourself as Prophet YOLO the Great. So you have to float a plan B, C, D, E. Anything to stop them calling you Cock Block O'Clock. And talking of cock blocking, it's a miracle that Marina has been canonised and celebrated at all, because she is venerated in the Maronite Catholic, Eastern and Coptic Orthodox churches, none of whom are particularly fond of feminism or any messing about with gender roles. Cross-dressing is, in fact, seen by them as a moral disorder. And yet Marina and her fellow female cross-dressers of the time now have churches named after them. These are women who lived as or disguised themselves as men and did so to survive or become monks. It wouldn't be fair for me to yak on about the hypocrisies of certain religious establishments still living in the times they were founded. Therefore, I won't mention how duh nugget, poxy ass, mouth breather, stupid upon stupid, centuries old sexism is. And vent we mustn't, because huzzah and woot, Marina shines on! Our sparkling star was a Christian saint of Byzantine Syria, which is now part of Lebanon. Marina was an only child, and as her mother died when she was a kidlet, she was raised by her devout Christian father, Eugenius, who had the genius idea to marry her off the minute he was able so he could retire peacefully at the monastery of Carnoubani. Eugenius's plan was put in place to save his own soul, but Marina was having none of it. Oh, my father, why would you save your own soul and destroy mine? She supposedly retorted. And if you aren't already head over heels in love with Marina, then I'm not sure how to help you. Ye of little faith. If you can stomach any more discrimination, then take note of the fact her father followed up his first bout of bias with the proclamation, "What shall I do with you? You are a woman." An announcement rather than a question, because he genuinely couldn't fathom why or how Marina could do anything other than marry a man and serve said boo. Shockingly, Marina had her own ideas and a tongue in her head to say them. She would join him at the monastery as Marinus the Monk. Despite her dad's threats that the devil would be on her like a fox on a bunny hutch, Marina told him to simmer down. She would shave her head and dress as a man. Job done. Marina and Eugenius fought the spiritual fight together for over 10 years. She was a proper model monk and practically perfect in every way. Her devotion doubled when her father passed away, and she began to pray, worship, fast, and practice piety for the pair of them. These increased levels of asceticism only helped her to conceal her true sex. All the man monks went on like everything was gravy, putting her soft voice down to too much praying and her lack of beard to the fact she must have been a eunuch. To top it all off, the Coptic Bible reckons that during this time, she was so miraculous and superior, she could heal the sick and dogfight away the devil. So much for the devil being on her case. She was booting the brute off like an unsuspecting gnat in the path of a Sporty Spice backflip. There were 40 monks at the monastery, and every month, four of the brethren were sent on a mission. I'm being vague here because it's only ever described as business. Perhaps they were spreading the monkey message. Perhaps they were flogging discount grain and cabbages off the back of a cart. We'll never know, so feel free to draw your own conclusions. What we do know is that there was an inn halfway to this business that the monks frequented, and the night Marina stayed there was another guest checking in. A soldier from the Eastern Roman front. This rude boy was also checking out the innkeeper's daughter and could have saved himself the price of his room because he stayed the night in hers. The booty call ended in the conception of a young perisher, and the soldier told the innkeeper's daughter to blame Marina, Marinus, for the mattress mambo that resulted in a child. When the girl started showing, she spilled the embellished beans and her dad went tearing down to the monastery to confront the abbot. Marina was bawled out something chronic, but she didn't deny involvement. Instead, understanding that this meant a young woman was in crisis, Marina confessed her sinfulness and asked for forgiveness. She was now the official baby father and got kicked to the curb, the actual monastery curb. She had to sleep and beg on its doorstep from that day forward. The innkeeper's daughter had a boy, and Marina took the son on as if he were her own, making parent moves to provide for him, such as kicking it with the local shepherds for quick access to free milk. She was perkier with fatherhood than a pig in the proverbial. Marina was a homeless single father for 10 years until the monks took pity on her. Took them long enough. And allowed her back on strict conditions. She had to perform hard labour, was forced to be a skivvy and then some. Eventually her boy became a full-blown monk himself, but he wouldn't have his father for long. Life was hard for Marina. The workload took its toll and she died at just 40 years of age. As the monks prepared Marina's body for her funeral, they discovered that she was a woman and there was mass hysteria. All sorts of weeping, praying and soul-searching ensued. Apparently, a monk who was blind in one eye was even cured of blindness just by looking at her body. The power of the vagina! Here endeth the story of Blessed Marina. Whether you believe all the devil beating, sick healing sort of stuff or not, I think we can all see eye to eye on the fact her life and personality was popping. Marina disobeyed in a time when most women could only dutifully obey. She showed determination, discipline, intelligence, strength, and grace. To quote from the translated Holy Syro-Antiochene rite, may we emulate in perseverance and endurance the manly woman so that our Lord may give us grace and mercy with her and the portion of the saints in the fearful day of judgment. I'm pretty sure our manly woman mopped up all the praise on her judgment day. Marina was considerably holier than most.
Joanna of Flanders, 1295 to 1374. The fiery commander, army raiser and hell raiser. Joanna is often considered one of the most extraordinary women of the age, and it is my absolute pleasure to explain why she blasted it. Strap in. This ride is sponsored by Brazenness, Nerve and A Woman Scorned. Expect some major turbulence. To ease you in gently, we'll start with some family blather. Joanna was Duchess of Brittany. Bloodlines and succession disputes played a fundamental part in her story. Joanna was born to Joan, Countess of Rutel, and Louis I, Count of Nevers. She married John of Montfort, half-brother of John III, Duke of Brittany, in 1329. John wasn't backwards in coming forwards and snapped up that duke title quick time when the third John died without any male heirs. His claim to fame was disputed by Joan of Penthièvre, the Duke's niece, and her husband, Charles of Blois-Châtillon. To cut a long story short, the House of Blois and the House of Montfort thrashed it out until the bitter end, and their battle royale became the War of the Breton Succession. To make a long story even shorter, Joanna made the defence of her dukedom pretty much her life's work. She had her eyes on the prize and was as stubborn as the pit stains on your favourite vintage shirt. As with all wars, this one was a bloody mess, made worse because there was also a wrestle for the French throne going down, involving the King of England, which carried on for about 100 years, so we neatly named it the Hundred Years' War. The French and English both promised to protect and support their respective sides and avoid any foul play. But Joanna already had an inkling there was going to be some punkin' among the ranks. She was right to be suspicious, because when her husband went to be heard by the King of France, the snake imprisoned him on the spot. To add fuel to the fire, he then made the decision, along with the French courts, to declare the House of Blois the true heirs to the duchy. Douche. The fire may have been stoked, but it was nothing in comparison to the flames raging inside Joanna. In fact, from here on in, she's most well known as Jeanne la Flamme, or Fiery Joanna, and it suited her down to a T. Charles of Blois started to prep his army to invade Brittany, but our blazing Jo had her own agenda. By this point, she had an infant son, who she announced leader of the Montfers. She knew she couldn't claim the title for herself, but she wasn't about to let that one slide. And she made sure King Edward III of England was on side and could basically send her back up. She pressed on by rounding up 300 men, and so her army was ready for battle. Jojo knew exactly who to use to her advantage, who to manipulate, and who to KO. By getting old Ed, King of England, on side, she could build an ally, avenge her husband, and help legitimise her son's succession to the French throne. Around this time, Joanna swung many a wrecking ball into the battlefield, but she's most well known for the siege of Ennebon in 1342, when her fiery side came out with a vengeance. There wasn't a hell's chance in France she was going to let the men take all of the glory. Joanna started by putting on her war paint, or in this case, she took up arms and jumped into a male soldier uniform and armour. Joanna completely ran the show, conducting the whole town and telling its women to cut their skirts and take their safety into their own hands. Ain't nobody got time to be in a skirt when there's a war to fight? In my mind, Joanna's got her skirt wrapped around her head and face like a balaclavaed ninja, and she's using her breast girdle as a slingshot to snipe unsuspecting enemies. But I've said too much already. The siege lasted for over a month, and Joanna showed mad skills as a military leader. In one of the most dramatic moments of the conflict, once referred to as the boldest and most remarkable feat ever performed by a woman, Joanna conceived a plan to storm the enemy camp. She'd been up and down the watchtower more times than the grand old Duke of York on a hill, checking the situation and ensuring her defence was progressing. When the timing was bang on, she ordered that 300-strong unit to charge and led the way. To sum up, they killed everyone in sight, set the whole place on fire and skedaddled sharpish. Joanna went missing for days, and the Blois boys presumed her dead. But our Fionado was simply biding her time, getting some R&R at a castle. Seems she knew about the Self-Love Club ahead of her time too. Jo had been lying low before heading back for more, and this time she was stepping things up a gear. Her army was now 500 strong, and she returned to Ennebon at the crack of dawn, keeping it casual, with a triumphant blast of musical instruments. Joanna could have gone hard or gone home, but she chose to go hard. Various complicated War of Breton succession plot twists occurred after this, but the most important detail to remember is that, thanks to Joanna, the Montfers were eventually victorious. However, sadly, by this time, Joanna had started to suffer from mental illness. She was basically sectioned and confined indoors, but to another castle at least. She died not long after her son won the duchy, but our girl went out in style. More recent evidence suggests that there was nothing to say she was actually mentally unwell, which makes you wonder if someone was trying to repress our role model. But again, I've said too much. Joanna's fire has got me all impassioned. She was daring, impulsive, and courageous. A medieval author at the time described her as having the courage of a man and the heart of a lion. Medieval misogyny aside for a sec, fiery Joanna was certainly a lion, a king, and roar she fluffin' well did.
Onorata Rodiani, 1403 to 1452. The fresco painting doublet wearing fighter with flair. The early Italian Renaissance was arguably the greatest period for art, and yet, I'll be damned, phenomenal female artists of the time hardly get a snuffle of a mention in the history books. Thankfully, we can put this right because this book would not be complete without an ode to Honorata. Known as the warrior paintress, or the Amazon, Honorata lives up to her blamtastic titles. There was certainly nothing basic about this paintbrush pro, and the same goes for her artwork. Female artists were quite rare back then, but there definitely weren't any women painting frescoes, Honorata's speciality. Creating huge works of art in the plaster of grand-scale walls and ceilings required scaffolding, apparatus far too precarious for a lady. And the job meant long periods of time away from home. The expectations for women started and finished at being wives and mothers. These medieval misses couldn't just jack it all in and mooch off for a few months, leaving the men to fend for themselves. Not only did Honorata somehow swerve all these traditional responsibilities and live footloose and fancy-free, she would have had and hired a male assistant. Hold my beer. Yes, Honorata had a man obeying her orders and perspiring under the hard knocks of being second best. Now, I know what you're thinking. This woman seems too good to be true already. But there's so much more to unpack. In fact, pour me another beer. Although little is known about her early years, Honorata was certainly part of the emergent bourgeois class, and there must have been some cash kicking about somewhere because nobody becomes a fresco pro overnight. Training was long and arduous, and Honorata would have had to slog to learn and master the technique. It requires serious skill and discipline. Artists can't afford to make a single mistake while at work, otherwise they'd have to ditch the lot. And if you think that's stressful, wait until you hear what a famous art historian of the day had to say about Honorata's expertise. Giambattista Biffi thought Rodiani's frescoes were, among a shower of other subtly blatant backhanded compliments, good for a woman. How can a man with the greatest name on the planet, Giambattista Biffi, a name that for some reason makes me want to hoover down gnocchi, prosciutto, pizza, tiramisu, gelato, and red wine, be such an idiot? Biffi might not have been bothered, but Honorata got the ultimate commission from someone who was. Marchese, or Italian nobleman to you and me, Cabrino Fondulo, who lived in a palace in Honorata's hometown of Castiglione, asked her to paint the entire crib, to pimp it. Honorata worked flat out for months, but there was also a workplace sexual harassment case to contend with. Usually it's men on the top of scaffolding, waltz whistling down to a woman while demanding to see the twins and dry humping the air. But this sex pest, one of Fondulo's esteemed courtiers, was heckling up to Honorata atop the scaffolding from the ground. The reverse levels clearly didn't make his behaviour any more acceptable, or Honorata's tether any longer. This predator, let's call him Harvey, it just sprang to mind. Harvey was as incessant as the cheap Ray-Bans hackers. He started with inappropriate comments and progressed to handsy behaviour before long. But it wasn't Honorata's hands Harvey was grabbing. Despite verbally putting him in his place many a time, Harvey wasn't getting the message. Honorata needed to get physical, and after one too many narrow misses, dodges and pushes away, our fatigued fresco virtuoso snapped. It is thought that Harvey attempted to rape her, and so lunging at him with a paintbrush wouldn't have been effective. Instead, she pulled out a knife. Honorata killed Harvey with a single shank. Frightened for her life, Harvey was Marquez's fave, and she knew he was going to throw a giant wobbler, Honorata decided to flee Castiglione. It was a good decision. Her boss flipped his lid all over the palace before coming to the realisation that he had a half-painted yard. Eventually, he would go on to pardon Honorata, because she was the best in the biz and he needed that fresco flair, but she was long gone. Disguising herself as a man, Honorata reinvented herself completely. Off in search of pastures new, believing it is better to be honoured outside my homeland than be dishonoured within. Honorata was remorseful about her actions, but it's also possible that she got a bit of a taste for blood because she became a mercenary soldier in the cavalry company of a chap named Odoardo Lampugnano. Another fine specimen of a name. Women were well over 500 years away from being able to sign up as soldiers or to fight, and so the only way for Honorata to do so was to continue living as a man. It seems like she got a taste for this too, because she kept up her disguise and her sword swinging for 29 years, only returning to her hometown when it was being invaded by the Venetians in 1452. Honorata led a troop of soldiers back into Castiglione like an absolute champ, but sadly, this was to be her last battle. As she lay on her home ground, slipping away, she was allegedly recognised by some of the locals who, after all that time, outed her as a woman. Some sources even say she found the energy to make a dad joke with her final breath by saying she was dying with Honorata. Her name meant honour. Let's just call this a fact because it's the most beautiful, poignant dad joke I ever did hear. The legend of Honorata lives on in Castiglione despite uncertainty as to whether any of her artwork does, although art history from Honorata's day rarely includes female artists. Aneurysms all round, her life and actions are rich enough to paint a picture of a creative and heroic rebel with guts to stand up, fight, and even kill for what she believed in.
Joan of Arc, 1412 to 1431, the ass-kicking soldier saint role model. Few medieval folk are as well documented as Joan. She's been adopted by new generations over the years and motivated all manner of mortals. Joan of Arc is a universally recognised historical female figure. School kids, pole to pole, will be able to rattle off all the big players famed within their classroom. Joan has made the company of favourites such as Henry VIII, Florence Nightingale, William Shakespeare, Queen Victoria, Nelson Mandela, and Ariana Grande. Joan is the star of umpteen books, plays, poems, works of art, and films, and the name of a brand of brie and a line of kidney beans. It is even thought she inspired the bob haircut. Until you've influenced a hairdo, cheese and, or a tinned good, you have no rights to say that you've made it. As the write-ups about anyone working class always start, Joan was born into humble beginnings. The daughter of a farmer residing in the peasant village of Domremy, Joan was illiterate and expected to amount to jack squat. France was in a bit of a state at the time. The Hundred Years' War was getting pretty rowdy, and the French army had not had any notable victories since forever ago. But among the burning villages and suffering, Joan was chatting with the heavens. At around the age of 12, J of A reckoned angels and saints started to visit her. Domremy was quite an isolated, dinky part of La France, so any visitors at all must have been the talk of the town. But the spirits weren't just passing through. Joan believed they gave her a divinely ordered mission. By age 16, the archangels had properly got into Joan's head, and she was adamant her sole job and purpose in life was to support the king, Charles VII, and save her country from English domination. Her fated life of farming and baby-making was going to have to wait. Joan almost continuously wore men's clothing. It seemed that for whatever reason, she made up her mind that they were her, and they were going to help her progress with her master plan. Perhaps she thought she would be taken more seriously the afternoon in February 1429, when she rolled up to the court of Charles VII to tell him God had sent her, in all her peasant teenage glory, to save him and the future of France. The King of England wasn't getting off lightly either. He received a letter from Joan stating that the maid promises and certifies that if you do not leave France, she and her troops will raise...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.